ladies and gentlemen, and welcome back from the final coffee break today. We are on the final road to a finale and a completion. And of course, we've still got some influential speeches for you now. Now, we've talked about what can be done for change, and of course, what is in store in the future. But now let's look ahead where procurement is going and how you can all impact in developing changes to fully achieve the 2020 vision and goals. Our next speaker, ladies and gentlemen, is going to be talking to us about new trends in procurement and the procurement model by 2020. Now, before I invite him onto the stage, may I encourage all of you just to have a look onto your tables, and there are some feedback forms in front of you. May we ask you to fill those out, and when they are done so, pop them into the center of your tables, where a couple of the lovely administration ladies will come and seek them later. So, ladies and gentlemen, I'm delighted to introduce our speaker. Let's meet Pranu Pratap Singh, Director of Procurement, Atlantis the Palm. Now, he joined in 2008 as an Associate Director of Procurement and has actively contributed towards the success of opening the resort. So, ladies and gentlemen, again, here to talk about the procurement with the vision of 2020. Please welcome to the stage, Pranu Pratap Singh.
Good afternoon. This session, which is mostly related to the procurement by 2020. In the entire presentation, which we are going to share for 25 minutes, I would like to share with you that what our Dubai government, which is thinking about the upcoming 2020 project, as well as in the domain of procurement, how things are working and how things are moving forward. So before we come to the point, I would like to share with you a Atlantis presentation, and we welcome you once again at Atlantis the Palm Dubai, and would like to share what we do as a hotel, what we do as an organization, as a resort. So may I request you to play a
The day starts early in Atlantis. Preparing. Cleaning. Feeding. Doing everything we can to make sure your day every day is the best day can be. Atlantis, an extraordinary experience, 24 hours a day. Atlantis, the Palm, Dubai.
Creating memorable experience and everlasting memory. That's what we are committed to. That's what the procurement team is also part of the entire journey. Every single moment, whenever we work, we make a decision. That's our journey, that we have to create everlasting memory and creating memorable experience and everlasting memories. To keep in mind that time is very limited, I would like to straightforward jump on the presentation, which is, in this presentation, before I go forward, I would like to say that I have used the information which is from the different sources. So, hence, it's just for the presentation purpose and say that what I want to convey and communicate with you. However, its purpose is to convey that what is needed as for us as a procurement. And what I try to put it here, that procurement by 2020, if we looking at the trend, where we are moving forward to. So supply chain by 2020 will be what we feeling and what we are looking forward will be more agile. And this has not, I'm saying, I think, before the presenter or the people who were before conducted the various presentation, everybody was indicating towards that. And I think this particular session is a very important session which summarizing everything together and saying that in a very definitive way, by 2020, where we are looking forward, we will be. The supply chain professionals have great ideas but fail to get them heard so often. Decisions are taken only from a commercial perspective. That's going to be a paradigm change because the industry or the organizations which we are working for, they want to move from this milestone to the next milestone. High-performing procurement team can deliver huge value to the organization, irrespective of the entire presentation. I would like to quickly run through. There are a couple of slides I may just quickly flip through. What I have spoken towards that when we are talking about 2020, we definitely need to keep in mind that the environment in which we are operating, what is the global scenario, and what is the opportunity available for us, including the sustainability which we spoke about, and efficiency which is needed for the organization. So I think it's very much clear where the oil prices were moving. It's also very much clear where the economy is moving. It's also very clear that how the exchange rates are moving. I think this is something which I don't need to reiterate once again, but this is our scenario around us. And in that scenario, we are looking forward to move with a history that what has happened in the area of the supply chain. So there were lots of journey has been undertaken by procurement and supply chain. But there are lots of things which is indicating that where we want to go and where we will be going. Like recently, the couple of people I spoke about the logistical change, which is Amazon and a couple of other stuff. But as far as the recent example is, the solar panel-driven plane. This aeroplane, nobody can even think about a plane can be driven by solar energy, but that's a reality of the life, and it's not anywhere else but next Emirates, which is Abu Dhabi, where the things are taking their in shape and reality. Keeping in mind that procurement is operating, again, the another environment in which we are operating is our customer base, is our people around us, is our stakeholder. So from that perspective, when we are talking about smart cities, smart building, smart wind clouds, smart material, definitely procurement is operating within that domain. And from that perspective, procurement also need to adopt and to work towards the environment which we are operating. There's a one statistic which come from HP, like by 2020 there will be 6 million mobile phones, 50 billion connected smart devices. This is the environment which we are in. The another thing, another way we can say, it's an era where everything is available on apps. So the question arises, this is the environment which we are operating. This is the thing which are happening. So what is business expectation from a procurement as a function? And definitely the expectation is very clear. That is bringing more initiative, bringing more value adds. Do not stuck just at the cost saving, because that is not the expectation from our business owner or business stakeholder. When I was just exploring that what was the most innovative company, the rating which has been done by the Forbes for 2015, the one company which is there on the top, Tesla Motors, is not a company who existed 4 or 5 years back. It's a very new company. But why they are different, why they are on the top? Because of the innovative idea which they converted into a business, and that's what something which taking them, I think, to the next stage. So this is an era where we are talking about the new supply management which is emerging. We all foresee that there are many more things which is happening around us. Now the people are talking about not only B2C companies where Amazon, Souq.com emerge, but we are also talking about a B2B platform where the people can trade, industry business can trade certain commodity item with the help of these platforms. There is a paradigm shift which is will be happening in 3 years time, where the profit replace cost saving. So industry or your business may not be looking that how much money as a procurement function we have saved, but they will consider as an overall business where we are and how much is procurement has contributed strategically to the profit, not only limited to the cost, because that is something which is the business need and business requirement and business expectation. So far, most of our procurement function are only limited to a transactional mode, where a strategy is going to creep in, and couple of the organization where is already been there. I think the earlier presenter who has given very clear statistics, but this is going to be a clear expectation from the procurement function that the procurement has to link the procurement strategy with the organization strategy, and that is something which is going to be a clear expectation of the business and none other than the e-marketplace from business to business is emerging, and it's not something which is just a discussion, but it's there as a reality. Ariba, the gentleman who was there, I think he also mentioned one of his platform, as well as there are many other platform which is providing and started working. So in a coming 3-4 year time, there would be a reality that you may find certain product which you are going to have an individual buying, you will be able to buy through an online platform the way you buy, so through souq.com or any other B2C portal. The another big change which going to happen, which will be a skill set change. One of the previous presentation, it was whether in a coming 4-5 year time, your job will remain safe or you have to add a new skill. Probably you have to keep adding new skill, that's what is expected. But definitely there is a skill set change which is needed, because the overall the things around us are in changing, and for that you have to recalibrate your skill sets. And a new definition of expert will emerge. That definition will suit the upcoming requirement of the professional procurement professionals. What that going to be? I think during the entire day, various presentation, somewhere or other, it has already been highlighted, already been indicated, already been projected that what sort of skill set, where is the direction the procurement and supply chain are moving forward. This is not going to be just a word, but that's going to be a reality, that talent competition will heat up. The another area which is which is expected to take a next step, a next milestone, which is instantaneous intelligent, which ultimately will come through, can say, big data analytics, and which ultimately will make lots of things irrelevant, and that will be price anymore will not remain as a secret. It will become more transparent. Like as of today, you want to buy an iPhone, you go to the souq.com, probably you find a better price than you go to the Jumbo and Jackie, and you go and find that. That's kind of era in other your buying pattern will emerge. Nevertheless, that will create the another challenge. And that challenge going to be, because it's going to be network community where the data, you are sharing your information with somebody else's information you are sharing with yourself, which ultimately will give you, will create a risk for the business, which is a data safety security. There would be another kind of things will emerge, which we have to find out that how it's going to be, like health and safety compliances, which will require some effective training. It's a best practice, require different operating standards. I think no organization can, in future, will remain untouched, because once you are dealing with a lots of transactions, then you're generating data. The data converted into a information, and that information is very, very valuable. So the data predicts not your historical, but it predicts the future, that which direction the upcoming 2 years, things will be moving, rather than how did it move in the past. That's something which today it looks little challenge, you find something different, but in coming forward, what we see, it's going to be a bit more, all such information will be really readily, easily will be available. When we spoke about that, it's going to go with a network community where is a buyer and supplier, or you can say you as an organization and your partner organization to whom you are working with will start, although it's already started long time back, but it will create more dependability on each other, and that will start a regime which is collaboration regime, which ultimately companies will dramatically increase their dependencies on suppliers for product services, manpower expertise, and new ideas. New idea is another very important point which come from your business partner, which he has more detailed insight than we as a buyer. Firms here, that's something then need to be rewarded in terms of risk which you are sharing and the benefits you are sharing. So that's the reason it will create the another reward. When you are definitely working with the entire thing, there are lots of risk which comes automatically. So every organization in that way has to learn, master the martial art, develop the necessary framework through which they can mitigate the risk, which may be a financial risk, which may be a data risk, which may be any other risk, which they have to learn this new thing and they have to develop from now onward. Because everything is going to be more likely automated. I'm not just sharing because that what we feel, I'm sharing with you because that what we have experienced so far. If I can share, if you allow me to share, then we started almost 6-7 years back where we decided to work through a manual process where every new upcoming organization start with. But as of today, I think most of our processes are automated. I can say 95% processes which procurement manages is fully automated. There are still 5% processes are remaining which we are committed to automate them, which we are committed to manage through an automated process. Which we are not at the edge of today is, we still did not go on a mobile, but that what is the objective and target is. One of the most important aspect which has been highlighted, multiple conversation previously, is sustainability. Do we have a choice? Or do we have to make ourselves committed to that, that what is expected out of us? The way I see, the way we move forward, Expo 2020, today we may have a choice, but moving forward, it will be a compliance. So hence, I think we need to prepare ourselves from effective from today onward, rather than waiting for when it becoming a compliance, then we are trying to do it, and which is clearly divided into three different sections, like social, environmental, and financial, which should create a positive environmental impact. And that's something which we foresee, and what I have shared with you is something which we foresee, we visualize, and we expect that that's what going to be the procurement in coming 3-4 years time coming forward. And that's what we look forward for. Thank you for...
Ladies and gentlemen, speaking there is Banu Singh. Many thanks from the Atlantis. And can I invite on stage to give his momentum, Abdul Aziz, Marketing Director of Blue Ocean Academy. Gentlemen, give them a round of applause. Many thanks and congratulations. Thank you. Ladies and gentlemen, I'm going to bring your attention again to the feedback form. All of you will find these on your tables. You may need to look under some other top papers. Please do fill it in. Remember, these conferences only get better with honest, constructive feedback. So do fill it in and then pop it into the center of your tables, and team members will collect them at the very end of the day. And we thank you in advance for your time. This is for your benefit. This is so that we can make this conference bigger and better every year. So, ladies and gentlemen, let's meet our final speakers for today. And of course, it is panel discussion number 3, why benchmarking is important to the supply chain. So, here to moderate this panel discussion, please welcome to the stage VP Menon, Managing Partner of UV Consultants. Now, he's going to be joined by the following 5 gentlemen. Dr. Satya Menon, Director of Academics at Blue Ocean Academy. Welcome, Doctor. Rajesh Bhandari, Director of Errant Foundation. Mazen Howasil, Head of Procurement, Banyas Investment Development Company. Ajay Krishnan, Vice President of CSS Group. Abdullah Alanazi, Senior Team Lead Procurement in Amitin. Can we get one more chair, please? Many thanks. And last but not least, Abdullah Alanazi. You're here already. That was quick work. Ladies and gentlemen, please give a round of applause to your panel discussion 3.
Thank you, gentlemen, for being part of this panel. We welcome you to discuss about benchmarking and supply chain. How are you all, audience? Great. Wow, fantastic. Nice to hear that word. Why benchmarking? Today, you all agree that we live in a very competitive environment. You agree that? Competition is tough, right? Today, whatever business we are into, we are competing with the best of the best from the international market. Gone are those days when we could relax a bit because competition was not so tough. We were mostly competing with the regional players or the local players or the domestic players. Today, no. We have to up our game. We have to compete with the best of the best. And believe me, today, customers are very difficult people today. There is no end to what they want. The more you give them, the more they want. And today, they demand the best from you, isn't it? And one way to up that, to move from one level of excellence to the next, to continuously improve in whatever you are doing, is benchmarking. So with that, I will like to kickstart my discussion with the first question to Dr. Satya. Why benchmarking? How does it benefit the organization? Why should we take all that effort to go through that painful process. For what?
Good evening, everyone. I believe benchmarking should be a part of the strategy in an organization. Many companies fail because they just say, okay, let's benchmark against the best, or let's benchmark against some company or some organization which is not relevant to our particular industry. Those kind of benchmarkings fail. So you should do benchmarking based on a strategy. That's what I believe. Now, benchmarking has to be based on time, efficiency, or value. Now, you can have different types of benchmarkings. One, generally an organization should start with internal benchmarking. They should have their KPIs set. They should be able to achieve based on whatever the objectives they are set, at least for continuously for some period of time. Then they should look at external benchmarking, where they can look at the best from other industries. But some organization straight away look into competitors, strategies or competitors' numbers to do the benchmarking. You do benchmarking to improve profitability. You do benchmarking to increase, the CSR. You can do the benchmarking to improve, like, sustainability. Somebody asked a question in the morning. You have a benchmarking for sustainability. You have an index, etc. So you can have all those. So that's what I believe.
Yeah? Thank you. Any of the panelists would like to add on this?
Hello, everybody. First of all, thank you for Blue Ocean for this invitation. And regarding benchmarking is one of the best practices actually you have to implement in supply chain department. As I agree with the doctor, he said it should be within the strategy of the supply chain department itself for each company. Because you cannot, the accuracy of selection of placing the order will be higher after benchmarking. So benchmarking is very important. Benchmarking will have a very good impact after benchmarking whatever you want to purchase or the service you want to provide.
Thank you very much. Ajay, an organization decides that, okay, benchmarking is to be done, we need to up our service, we need to move from one level of excellence to the next, we need to do what the best of class is doing. Now, in the whole process, people have a misunderstanding that we tend to spend a lot more money in the whole process, our cost increases. Yeah? Customer is happy because we are delivering better service, but in the bargain, our cost efficiency is getting affected negatively. Do you think that's true? What is your opinion about it?
Can we have one more mic here, please? Good evening, everyone. I have to take this back to the previous responses that came in as to why benchmark, right? Now, you benchmark, obviously, because you feel you've pinpointed bottlenecks or you're looking for an objective evaluation of your process, one of the two. Now, with any process, when you re-engineer a process, there will be a cost element to it. Could be direct cost to your bottom line, or it could be cost of resources, manpower, etc. But oftentimes you've seen that when you're able to actually pinpoint where the bottleneck is and tackle that objectively, the cost that's incurred, again, be it a direct cost or an indirect cost, could actually drive you, it could be a value-driven saving for you at the end of the day. Provided you get it right the first time and don't spend your time re-engineering it each time, because that's when the bottom line gets affected, right? So as long as we're able to get a qualitative and quantitative analysis done first go, that should give you a pretty broad enough perspective of where things are going wrong, if it is going wrong, and a one-time cost per se. again, I stress on the word one time because it could be a direct or indirect cost. And if we get that analysis right, then there really isn't an impact to you going forward. You could actually fix the problem without really having to re-engineer each time.
Yeah, so in the long run, the organization will understand that, in fact, they actually saved a lot of money.
Provided we don't end up re-engineering it again. Yeah, so it's imperative to get the process right the first time, which is why the benchmarking process itself is very key to identify where the bottlenecks are.
Fantastic. And once you have set those best practices in place and we've benchmarked our processes to be the best in the industry, what we also find is that a lot of efficiency creeps in because there is less rework, there is less defects, there is less customer complaints.
Correct.
Yeah? A lot of those things, I think, automatically keeps happening.
Implementation of those, of your conclusions of your benchmarking, implementation of those results are key. If you don't implement them the right way, and that comes only with sponsorship as well, you have to have buy-in from stakeholders to actually go ahead with it. Because that there could be an element of cost, there could be an element of time involved in implementing it. If you don't have the buy-in, if you don't do that, then you will constantly end up re-engineering the process.
Thank you. Thank you. Rajesh, if I could ask you to elaborate a little bit on the different types of benchmarking that we could actually look into pertaining to supply chain management, of course, within the field of supply chain management.
Okay. Good evening, guys, first. As Dr. Menon already mentioned, if you see, benchmarking is talked about worldwide in terms of different industries. We talk about different companies. We talk about different countries and so on and so forth. But wherever you go in the world, normally the benchmarkings are divided into four major types. The first one, what we say, is called as internal benchmarking. When we say it's an internal benchmarking, that means we are talking about that within the companies, they have got, like, for example, you know, it's an it's a conglomerate wherein they have got different divisions. So when you compare the different purchasing or procurement departments into these different divisions, then we normally say it's an internal benchmarking. The second type of benchmarking is normally called as a competitor's benchmarking. When you say competitor's benchmarking, that means, as the word says rightly, that what our competitors are good into and what we are not into, like the sweet spot and the sore spot, what we normally talk about, that is nothing but we talk about as a competitor's benchmarking. The third benchmarking is normally called as a functional benchmarking. In a functional benchmarking, it's basically, it grows across the functions in different industries. Like, for example, you know, there is a company which is into FMCG, and there is a company into contracting. So the different departments into this, the same department into these two companies, when they compare each other, normally we say it is a functional benchmarking. And finally, which is called as a generic benchmarking. Though the word, it is very simple to say generic, but this is one of the most important benchmarking which lot of big companies having big strengths, normally they do it in terms of generic benchmarking. So generic benchmarking is across the functions, it is across the businesses. When we compare, it is normally called as a generic benchmarking. So if you see, in terms of this benchmarking, when we talk about, it is for the companies to decide, because we are talking about the cost elements in here, right, and the time elements and so on and so forth, and the you're talking about the re-engineering processes. It always goes by first as to the company where they want to really pitch themselves, and then eventually go towards the different benchmarking modes as to different, you know, types what I already mentioned about. So in turn, just to keep it in short, there are different ways of benchmarking the companies, different methodologies which can be used to benchmark the companies, and then, you know, that's only important thing is to start in terms of being the best practice as well.
Fantastic. Thank you, Rajesh. Now, we all know that, and we've heard this many, many times, that if we continue to do what we are doing, we will continue to get what we are getting, isn't it? So benchmarking becomes important to move to that next level, yeah? So that we do things which we are not doing today, so that we get what we are not getting today, yeah? We get much more than what we are getting today. But the question is, whom do we benchmark against? Do we always go and look at the best in class and say, oh, okay, I'm going to benchmark against them? Is that a good strategy to follow? Always benchmarking against the best in class in whatever you're doing? Mazen, can you elaborate on that a bit?
Good afternoon.
From your personal experience, of course.
Absolutely. Good afternoon, everybody. I'm going to use a frame of reference from the United States, where I've had the opportunity to work for some time before coming to the UAE. The reason why I'd use that is because I've noticed that when we speak on benchmarking, and depending on the different fields and the different industries, sometimes the MENA region can be still somewhat in the adolescent stages of developing best practices for benchmarking. One of the things that the gentlemen have touched on is engineering and implementing the benchmarking. What I've noticed that is a lot of times some of the organizations will find and identify other organizations of a similar type. So if we're talking construction, they'll find general contractors that will be of a similar stature and handle a similar turnover for a contract value, as an example. They will establish communications in between themselves through different channels, whether it be through the executive management or various figureheads within the department. Through those avenues, then they're able to establish one of the key elements in implementing the engineering of benchmarking is the scope. So what is it that we're going after? Are we trying to establish how do we effectively save on procedures for the time durations of maybe implementing a contract, mobilization times when we're awarded a contract and the people are bringing their staff and accommodations and whatnot? When you have this partnership established with similar type-like organizations, and you're able to establish an effective type of scope, then I feel that it's a more fruitful exercise that not only brings you about more efficiencies, but you also establish a rapport with these other organizations. So as one of the highlights of the conference today has been e-procurement and technology. So as technology grows in advance and all of us have to start to adapt in different ways that we might have not been comfortable previously, and also we have the issue of, like he highlighted, Mr. Ajay, about the buy-in from management in order for us to execute these benchmarking, you have the opportunity now of, okay, well, these people are partners at this other organization. Although they might be a competitor, this is some of the things that they've proposed and they're put forward, and this is going to give them an advantage over us if we don't take a similar type approach. So it gives you also that sort of leverage on your management, other people, and your stakeholders to see, okay, these are the benefits for us to go ahead and implement whatever type of benchmarking we wish to establish.
Thank you. That was a point which you, which was very important about technology, yeah, the use of technology. Now, benchmarking is purely data-driven, right? It's not that, oh, I think this is the way to do it, yeah? It's purely data-driven. There's a lot of metrics involved in understanding where you are right now, in understanding where you want to be, and the whole journey itself is, you know, monitored and measured throughout. I want you, Mr. Abdullah, to elaborate a little bit on the use of technology and the best practices that we follow nowadays using technology in the process of benchmarking.
Actually, I want to follow up regarding what Mr. Rajesh just said about the competitors' benchmarking, which is very important. Actually, from a real example, we have done in our procurement department a benchmarking with the competitors who are using SAP system. And what are they customizing exactly to speed up the process of the procurement and supply chain and make it efficiency? We have done a benchmarking among all five competitors, and then we have reduced the costs. After that, we paid. At the beginning, we paid. But later on, it was like very good. It has a very good impact on our department, and the technology we have used is supporting us a lot after the benchmarking we have done. So using technology, using even some other factors and benchmark it among your competitors is a very good idea. But you have to select the competitors, good competitors, not like anyone else, like who is in the same range of your business line, I mean. And today I'm very happy to speak beside Mr. Rajesh because I'm one of the students, actually. So it's a pleasure to meet you again here. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Mr. Abdullah. Anybody, Satya, would you like to add a bit more on the use of technology? You know, what are the new ways that technology can be brought in to make the benchmarking process itself easy? Communication becomes easy. Everybody understands everything the same way. There's no confusion. Yeah. So, what do you think?
Ajay talked about business process re-engineering.
See, when you do business process re-engineering, technology can come into a big play. See, like when we used to go for SAP implementation projects, we never used to carry the legacy systems or legacy process into the new hardware or the new software. So we always did business process re-engineering. And when from as-is process, when we made the 2B process, we created all the statistics or all the numbers what we would like to achieve. For example, when we talk about inventory, when we want to do benchmarking for inventory, it can be based on, see, the entire supply chain strategy can be based on two drivers. That's what I believe in. Either it can be a responsive supply chain or it can be an efficient supply chain. Let's say, for example, for organizations like CSS, efficiency might be a big driver in their operations, but for an organization like Cleveland, in the morning when David McNamara spoke, they cannot be an efficient supply chain. Possibly their inventory management should be more responsive to the customers. Yeah. So the benchmarking has to be based on these two. So when you bring the technology element into this, so you have to be very clear which driver, which strategy I'm following for the supply chain, and the entire process, whether you're using SAP or Oracle or any other software, that has to be built into that. Yeah, so that's what I believe.
Okay, now we know that, okay, we measure where we are, and as Stephen Covey says, you know, rule number two, begin with the end in mind. Okay, so we know where we want to reach. Okay, this is what I want to, where I want to go. Now, between from where you are to where you want to go, you do a lot of work, you put in a lot of actions, yeah? In the whole process, what are some of the common pitfalls or challenges that you face? And this question is open to all of you. All of you can comment on it. From your own personal experiences, what are the normal challenges that we come across? Would you like to start?
Yes. Actually, you don't know and you cannot expect like what are the challenges you can, you have faced or you may face during benchmarking or implementing actually the new idea that you are planning to do. So, risk management and plan for whatever hidden in the future. And this is, I think, one of the best practices that should be done probably in the beginning before benchmarking. Okay, now I am here, I want to be there, but until I reach, there are some things need to be studied carefully and I have to study the plan all. And to like avoid all the problems or like difficulties we may face later on. So with the good planning, benchmarking, then we can reach to whatever we want.
Okay. Anybody wish to?
Yeah. You want?
No, after you.
See, two important elements which I've come across. When we talk about benchmarking, is one is change management. People don't want to change. One, they feel, oh, so many people have come, so many people have gone. What are you going to do? Whether you are a top guy in an organization or you're working in the middle management, bringing in a change becomes very difficult. But when you talk about benchmarking. The second one is, people believe when you talk to them saying that, no, we are already doing the best, you know. So there is nothing beyond this, what you're trying to do. There is nothing beyond. You can never achieve something what is beyond. People will break or the processes will break. But people seldom realize that, like what His Highness Sheikh Mohammed told in his Vision 2020 speech, that in the race for excellence, there is no finishing line, yeah.
I think you just touched on one of the key points is getting buy-in from the executive management, because constantly you'll have what we consider or the term I'm used to, the old guard. People have their own comfort levels within an organization. So if you come to an established organization that's, you know, three decades old, and has been established, or maybe it's a family type governed organization, there's certain comfort levels that people have already established and that have been set in stone, whether it's good or bad. So one of the biggest hurdles that I've found anytime you want to make and implement any change or modernize any system is getting the buy-in from the executive management or people who've been established players.
Sorry. Yeah, this brings me back to the previous question that you had as well in the technology. So it's kind of correlated. Being on the other side of the business, I am a logistics solutions provider for my customers, and one of the common challenges we always face is your deadlines. You need to deliver on a particular time, a particular date, at a particular cost as well. Oftentimes we've seen that, and I go back to a study done by Supply Chain Digest, in a random sample survey of about 300 companies, Fortune 200, Fortune 500, about 36% of them are using ERP-dominated platforms for their supply chain. No disrespect to anyone designing ERPs independently, but out of that, only 17% are totally integrated on a technology front as well, which means incorporating every aspect of the supply chain industry, including us, logistics providers, production, manufacturers, everyone. Not many of these systems, except for a few which are very well known, incorporate a transport management system or TMS, which is what we try to do. We try and introduce that as well as much as we can. But without that, the visibility on where you're going wrong on your lead times or your delivery times on your supply chain per se goes wrong. Because at the end of the day, supply chain, if you put it simply, is delivering the right product, the right time, to the right place, at the right price, which is not very relevant today, right? But that's the biggest challenge we face. How do you keep that flow in, understanding what the customer needs without the visibility? So I still believe there's a lot of room for technology to be integrated into some of these systems. Again, coming back to what you said.
Thank you very much. Now we will spend the next few minutes taking questions. If any questions from the audience, yeah.
Good evening. I am Abhijit from Centrum. I have one or probably two questions with this regard. One, what are the criteria you are likely or you are expected to take when you are doing the benchmarking? And if the scenarios are different, how are you going to compare apple to apple? Third important thing, in a scenario like UAE, where most of the companies are LLCs, they don't disclose their data. How are you going to benchmark and against whom? On what basis?
Yep. Gentlemen, who would like to
I was going to say, is that directed to anybody in particular? No, it's an open forum.
Okay. So, hello, Abhijit. Yeah, I know him already. And that's why I think he has put the question through. You see, guys, normally when we talk about benchmarking, and this is a normal fact, what we always talk about. Just to add on a little on benchmarking, I always believe that there are three very important words, or rather statements you can say in terms of benchmarking. The benchmarking cannot be successful unless and until there is a coordination, there is a collaboration, and there is an integration. If these three things are not there, you know, the benchmarking will normally always fail. But if you see, guys, now when we talk about, as what he mentioned, that if there is no data, people don't share data and things of this kind, always remember, it's always that benchmarking also is directly dependent on the circumstances as well. If you see, the same company which had a benchmarked, you know, a particular standard which they want to achieve and they have achieved, that particular benchmarking standard also changes over time, because the environment around the company has also changed as well. So if you see, when we talk about as an environment for the same company as well, could change the standards of the benchmarking as well. Now coming back to, in terms of the competition or the competition benchmarking. Now as regards to the competition benchmarking, if you see the benchmarking which has been implemented in one country, in a particular industry, is not necessarily be successful for the same type of industry in another country as well. The reasons are plenty, which you all know about. Could be the laws, regulations, could be we talk about the environment in which we work for, could be the qualification per se in which it has been implemented, And then in terms of the systems, support what you get in terms of implementation as well. So just to answer your question, in my views, it is that yes, certainly you're absolutely on the dot that it is very difficult or challenging to do it. But at the same time, having this challenge does not necessarily mean that we should not implement it as well. You see, they always say that, you know, there is a very well-known saying which all of you are aware of. You don't know what you don't know. Am I right? You don't know what you don't know. But once you know that what you don't know, you can always act upon it. So this is what we talk about always of benchmarking. That when we talk about benchmarking and when the companies normally go for analysis, they find that, okay, these are the areas where which we can have perfection or we can go towards the, you know, escalation of whatever the systems we are. And then adopting that to what your standards of your company per se is, in terms of how much, because, you know, if you see, you know, Mr. Menon was also mentioning before, in terms of the, you know, the product costing, for example, how much it is going to cost me. Maybe it cannot be afforded by all the companies in the same industry as well. So if you see that in terms of the pricing, for example, maybe it is not affordable or maybe it is not worthwhile spending for a smaller company, it could happen. In that context, it is not that I will not take this benchmarking. I'll try to implement, but to whatever extent and, you know, time frame, what I can for.
Thank you.
So in simple terms, sorry, just to say that yes, it definitely changes, but at the same time, by reengineering, we can definitely implement.
Thank you, Rajesh. Thank you, Rajesh. I would like to quickly add that, you know, that region-specific, country-specific, market-specific tweaks will have to be made. You can't blindly copy-paste things. Yeah, and to answer to your last question, data is not available. So whom? How do I do it? Yeah, there are other ways of doing it. There are companies, there are consultants, you know, there are bodies who would know what that the best of benchmarking is for that kind of industry, for that kind of specific market. So you could get help from them. Yeah, because sometimes it's very difficult to get data from a company itself. Yes.
Menon, I'm feeling very ambitious. We've got two final questions.
Okay, thank you.
And it means that each of them, with replies, have 2 minutes each. Let's see if we can achieve it. 2 minutes per question.
Hello. Hello. Thank you, panel, for giving loads of information for us. Myself, Dinesh Kumar from Fetcher.us, a logistics solution provider. Here we are a bunch of young professionals who are working as a project manager. We are trying to bring more change management into our supply chain team, like more like benchmarking. But as discussed in the panel, change is little difficult to people around us. So as seniors, we would request you to give some insights or tips how to handle change management very practically on the shop floor.
Shop floor. You mean within the factory? Yeah, if I understand your question right, I think it's really how do you drive the change forward when you have the old guard stopping it? Is that really what you're asking? How do you drive the change forward, right, when you have resistance?
Yeah, actually it's not, I will not say resistance. It's a new concept we are bringing inside, but the people over there are, as you said, they might think that they are doing at the best, but we want to prove them that still there are better ways to elevate. So how you will make them to understand?
I'm sure everyone will have a comment, so I'll start with one. I think this is what I came in with the first thing, saying you need buy-in from stakeholders. If you don't have the buy-in, it's going to be very difficult to push it beyond a particular point. The last one for me is if you show the value in terms of a cost saving, that should in itself be able to open people's eyes. Not necessarily drive it forward without the buy-in, but you have a justification to push it through.
Buy-in is very important. I mean, taking the team into confidence is very, very important if it needs to be a successful project.
Okay. I would just say from personal experience, especially when it relates to your superiors or your line manager, just make sure you have like a side discussion with them before you formalize your request or your presentation to them, so that way they have some time to digest what it is that you might be coming to them with.
And I think you need to have that vision clear, that outcome clear, you know. If you have the outcome clear and you're able to communicate that vision or that outcome very clearly to the other party, you would easily get them to agree on it, because at the end of the day, both of you want to improve things, yeah, for the company, for the customer.
Menon, we've got last time question. For just one final question. Your name, your company, and your one question, and reply within 1 minute, 45 seconds.
Hi. My name is Pasalik Paul. I'm from Aramex LLC. Just a quick question regarding the, you said about the benchmarking. I just want to know, basically supply chain management is like end-to-end, like from customer demand to customer satisfaction. So both, it's just like all the value additions coming from the customer demand, which is maybe from the marketing team or maybe from the sales team, whatever you're coming from, and to the customer satisfaction for the delivery, the final delivery. That's what I believe the supply chain management exists. When you say benchmarking, most of the time that supply chain and the procurement fails to achieve the targets just because that we get over-exaggerated, the plan, over-exaggerated forecast. Sometimes the dynamics of the market is not being captured. So in that pattern, how do we, you know, how can we achieve the benchmarking? You know, even though we achieve the benchmarking, we won't be able to get the desired results. How does it require to get integrated with the other teams?
Thank you very much.
See, this is a very common misconception when it comes to benchmarking. Are we getting exaggerated targets? But think of bodybuilding. If you want to build your body, you cannot just take the dumbbell and just like that, you know? You cannot, the muscles will not come out. So only when you stretch your muscles to the maximum, the new muscles comes out. See, I'm not an expert in bodybuilding, so we have somebody here who was Mr. Asia for many years. I'm sure he will be able to give you better guidance, but from some tips which he has given me, or I'm sure which is common knowledge, you have to stretch yourselves. Then only new systems, new processes, new innovations will come. You know, when I went to China, I visited a Haier factory. Every factory of Haier, there is one big sentence which is written, or two words written by their chairman. Disruptive innovation. So unless you have disruptive innovation, you cannot grow your organization. So thinking that it's exaggerated, thinking it is non-achievable is killing the baby before it is born. Yeah.
Thank you. Thank you, Satyen. To just to wrap up, gentlemen, since we are out of time, know where to set the bar. Know what the outcome is that you expect from your benchmarking process. Understand how high the bar is. Get buy-ins from the team, yeah, so they feel responsible. Remember that you may spend a lot of money and time in doing this exercise, but at the end of the day, most of the supply chains who have done benchmarking against the best in class operate at a much lower cost over a longer period of time. And remember that measurement data is the key. I mean, any improvement process starts with measuring where you are and knowing where you want to go and measuring the whole journey. So that's it from us. Thank you very much, panelists. It was a pleasure having you with us. Thank you. And I'll hand you back to the MC.
Just stay there. Gentlemen, delighted to have you all on for the panel discussion. Can I invite onto the stage to give some mementos, Mohammed Al Ali, Senior Vice President, Head of Global Transaction, Corporate Banking, FGB. Ladies and gentlemen, Mohammed Al Ali. And he's going to be giving three mementos to Mazen Hawasil. Ajay Krishnan. And Abdullah Alanazi. Ladies and gentlemen, give them all a big round of applause. And of course, thank you very much to our moderator, Mr. Menon. Fantastic effort. Thank you, gentlemen, for a fruitful conversation. I'm delighted to invite Mohammed Al Ali to give a short speech before he is going to be presenting three plaques. So, ladies and gentlemen, again, please welcome Mohammed Al Ali to the stage.
Bexa, is it the last speech? I think.
Very, very nearly.
Are you bored, guys? I think Dr. Satya, he was talking about sport. May I ask everybody to stand up? Take a deep breath while you're closing your eyes. Release. Please have a seat. You just inhale oxygen in your brain. I guess some people, they were sleeping or tired. I don't want it to be in a boring speech. Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. In fact, it's a beautiful view from here, believe me. I'm so delighted to be here today. And I would like to thank Blue Ocean for inviting me and giving me this opportunity to participate in this event. I've known Blue Ocean for a long time. In fact, I was fortunate to attend one of professional training, Six Sigma, green and black. Believe me, it was difficult, but very interesting, and interesting for all, most of the organization. You know the beauty, I'm not here to give about recruitment, neither about training. I know most of you, they are athletes and going to the sport, but what's the interesting here about Blue Ocean, I've noticed that today we talk about supply chain, recruitment, Six Sigma, and human resources, contract management, and project management. A lot of things which is need in this market. All internationally certified program. And that's exactly any person he's aiming to achieve it. How to invest in education, invest in business. Today, I'd like also to congratulate some people for the great achievement, and I believe it's an added value in their personal life, plus their career advancement. Somebody today asked me about what am I doing here. I'm working in the bank as a head of global transaction banking, which is related to all business around the world. We do trade finance, cash management, and we lend money. Money is king. Although sometimes could be the root of the all evil. It all depends how to use it. I'm available here for any question you guys, as a businessman, owners, people, if they need any question, anything related to finance, related to consultancy, related to also advisory, where trade finance needs, or cash management. Wish you all the best, and have a good evening.
Ladies and gentlemen, Mohammed Al Ali. Mohammed's work is not quite done yet. He's going to be joined on stage now by Dr. Satya Menon from Blue Ocean Academy. Ladies and gentlemen, Dr. Satya. Now, together, they have two tasks. The first one is they're going to be giving away the Procurement Best Practice Appreciation Awards, of which there are three. And then we're going to be thanking our sponsors today. So, ladies and gentlemen, we have three Procurement Best Practice Appreciation Awards. The first one goes to Emirates Hospital. The next award goes to O&G Engineering Kuwait. Ladies and gentlemen, O&G Engineering. And the next and final award goes to Thumbay Group. So congratulations to those three winners, again, of the Procurement Best Practice Appreciation Awards. Ladies and gentlemen, please give all three a big round of recognition applause. And of course, as we depicted right at the very beginning of the day, these events cannot happen without the support of our sponsors. So we'd also like to recognize all of our sponsors whom we have mementos for. So can I please invite to the stage our platinum sponsor, NTCO. Many thanks indeed. Ladies and gentlemen, NTCO. Our technology partner, SAP Ariba. Ladies and gentlemen, if you know you're a sponsor, can I encourage you just to walk forwards? Yep, come to the sides here. Ladies and gentlemen, a round of applause, SAP Ariba. We'd like to extend our thanks to our gold sponsors. They are the following. Three, Logical Freight Services, Sinbo, and Hire. Again, they're Logical Freight Services, Sinbo, and Hire. Great to have you all on board. Many thanks. We'd like to thank our silver sponsors in the following order: CSS Group, Zebra, Intertech, The Canoe Group, StarMat, Goldfinch, and Cricket Sporto. Again, in the following order, CSS Group, Zebra, Intertech, The Canoe Group, StarMat, Goldfinch, and Cricket Sporto. Ladies and gentlemen, our final silver sponsor. Many thanks indeed. And we'd like to thank our strategic partner, Colourbloom. Ladies and gentlemen, a big round of applause. Colourbloom, our strategic partner. We'd like to invite on stage our lanyard partner, Janai Logistics. Ladies and gentlemen, a round of applause, Janai Logistics. Silver sponsor, Gateway Computers. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Zebra Technology, silver sponsor. Final sponsor is social media partner, Wow Digital. So, ladies and gentlemen, can we have a big round of applause finally for all of our sponsors and, of course, our awardee givers, Dr. Satya and Muhammad Al Ali. Thank you both very much. I'm going to keep Muhammad Al Ali on stage just a little bit further. Yes, we're not quite done. We've got to make sure he works for his dinner. We are, of course, now going to be going on to the next awards. These are the convocations, and it is in the following order. Now, can I invite on stage the following people? We're going to have two people who are going to be reading the lists of awardees for the convocations. Those people are going to be Sheba and Irfan. If you'd like to come and read the following 24 awardees, and Mohammed Al Ali is going to award the following 24 awards.
As mentioned, my name is Carlo Moya Gomez, and I am an HR manager, take care of two properties here in Dubai. I just finished the course on CHRP and continuing my learning journey on CHRM. It is quite weird for me to take these courses since I've been practicing HR for the past 6 years. You might even think or even give me a remark that I'm wasting my time. When Maita, one of the consultants, approached me to take these courses, I was a bit hesitant at first. However, due to her persistence, I gave in and honestly made the right choice. She helped me realize that during these competitive times, having substantial experience is great, but coupled with certifications, I am paving my way from effectiveness to greatness. From day one, I was impressed of the level of service as well as the caliber of facilitators of Blue Ocean Academy. The team is very approachable and possess the second nature to assist. I was even more impressed when somebody called me from the academy on the day of my birthday last month. A simple gesture, however, the impact was a positive memory. I have shared these learnings and experiences to my HR friends, and they are now enrolled in these courses. Now, how do I describe Blue Ocean Academy? Well, if Harvard is the benchmark, Blue Ocean Academy is the Harvard of Dubai, and you can quote me on that. John Maxwell once said that successful and unsuccessful people do not vary greatly in their abilities. They vary in their desires to reach their potential. I believe this is the key message of why we are here today. We want to reach our potential. Blue Ocean Academy, thank you for being the catalyst for our continuous improvement. Thank you for being the way to reach our potential. Have a great evening.
Thank you.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah. Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Sahra Al-Fatairi. I am working as a territory manager at FedEx Express, and I took up two courses in Blue Ocean. Before I speak further, I want to congratulate everyone who will be getting their certificate this evening. As mentioned earlier, I took up two courses. One, it is HR professional, and the second, it was human resource management. I may still not be in HR in my company. However, I get a better understanding of mission, vision, rules, and the procedures, and the country when it comes to employment and how this knowledge can improve our role in the company. These courses also help me understand the hiring procedure in putting the right person in the correct position. It helped me understand people, service, profit. This is my company philosophy, my KPIs. These courses help me understand where I am now and how far I want to reach. I can say all these immense skills and understanding I got still with full support from Blue Ocean family. With Blue Ocean, the caring and support never stop when you get your certificate. They truly care about our future. Blue Ocean Academy create a professional environment for us that is comfortable and that enhance collaborative relationships. To keep it shortly, Blue Ocean experience made me a manager, made me leader and follower. Ladies and gentlemen, it is an honor for me tonight to share my experience with you. So, on behalf of all the students, I can say thank you, Blue Ocean. Thank you. Thank you.
Mr. Ataul Mustafa is our CHRP student. He wants to share his experience with Blue Ocean Academy. Over to you.
Actually, this is not any phrase to Blue Ocean. Actually, this is my story that how I get the certificate from Blue Ocean. Actually, the story start from when my mobile screen broke, unfortunately, and I was in market in Abu Dhabi in Dalma Mall. And I already want to do some certification courses. I am already done master degree in HR from Pakistan. But you know, for a fresher, there is a short way to get certified from any of institute in UAE, and then you can get the latest laws and the practice following UAE. So that time I get call from one of my fellow in Dubai, and he told me that there is one institute who is providing certifications in HR. So that time I postponed my buying of a new mobile, and next day I called Blue Ocean, and they told me that this will be the fee category to get a certified. And you all know that for a fresh employee in UAE, the salary is not so much. So I told them that I will do the course, but after 2 months, I will contact you and I will do the course. But Mr. Azizullah said me that we are not offering the course for the money. We just want to make more professionals, certified professional in UAE. So he told me to pay the amount in the installments, and there was no security check from my side because only I have the ATM card, no checkbook was with me. So he given me opportunity to get certified as per my own wish, as much I can pay him in installments, and he given me opportunity to stand here in front of you as a certified professional. So, so Blue Ocean is not only doing the business, actually they are spreading knowledge. Knowledge is very important. I can put example that the first war which was fought in Islam, Ghazwa-e Badr, our Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said to the prisoners, whoever knows writing or learning, whoever can teach 10 children writing, learning, he will be set free. So Blue Ocean is following that same rule which our Prophet explained 400 years ago, that money is nothing for Blue Ocean, they only spreading the knowledge in UAE.
Bless you. Okay. Thank you very much indeed. Ladies and gentlemen, a big round of applause, and can I invite all of our certificate holders back onto the stage. Let's look at our next certificates. They are the Certified International Supply Chain Professional and Manager. And we have some students who would like to share their two-minute experience with us. May I please invite to the stage our Arthanat Manoj. Arthanat Manoj.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. I'm Manoj. I am from Qatar, and I work with a leading shipping company called CMA CGM. I have decided to do the Certified Supply Chain Professional and Supply Chain Manager course a few months back, and I was lucky enough to have a course certification happening in Qatar, and it was an extremely, I would say, the course materials, the faculty, and the way the course was conducted, it was definitely above my expectations. So I am delightful that I have decided to do the course, and I will certainly recommend all my friends, my business associate who is involved in the shipping and logistics to do this course and get certified. And once again, I'm thanking you the Blue Ocean and their team for their excellent work. Thank you.
Inviting to the stage, Kiran Save.
Good evening, everybody.
telling about me, I have been associated with Blue Oceans for more than 5 years and above. It's been an amazing experience since then. The recent courses, what I have been done is Six Sigma, which has opened a whole new horizon for me in today's world. Each and every member in the staff of Blue Ocean has been so positive and has always motivated me to take up some amazing courses which are designed perfectly for the upcoming markets. Also, to add, the best of venues are selected by Blue Oceans. Maybe it for the lectures or our convocations. All my professors are encyclopedia of knowledge. I can also say my experience in life, education is one of the biggest investment you can invest in present, as it will give you best returns in your future. I feel great to be associated to reputed institution like Blue Oceans. Thank you for hearing me, my friends.
Yeah. Well done, Kieran. Congratulations. And inviting, finally, Louis Nyalifa.
Yeah. Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Louis Nyalifa. I work for Air and Partner Solution. Why I took the course? Actually, we offer a segment of the supply chain solution, that is the warehousing logistics. And we have to provide different solutions to our customers in terms of how they optimize their warehouse. Customers. In terms of the stuff, in terms of the lectures, yes, the known basic knowledge I was taught, but what I enjoyed the most was the experience from Dr. Satya, VP Menon. I think the immense experience they had was something that I will always treasure. Thank you, Blue Ocean, and wishing you all the best.
Well done. Thanks, Louis. Great stuff. So, ladies and gentlemen, this is where I invite onto stage our next readers, who are Shafi and Vipin. And to give the certificates, can I invite back on stage Dr. Satya from Blue Ocean Academy. Please welcome them onto the stage. And, of course, this is for the Certified International Supply Chain Professional and Manager. to the Certified Purchasing Professional and Manager. And we've got two of our students to share their experience in 2 minutes. Again, can I invite Jitu and Jamal to be the readers? And I'll be inviting Abdul Aziz from Blue Ocean Academy to present the certificates. First is Miss Sharila George.
My name is Sharila George, and I head the Procurement Department at Al Shirawi Engineering Services Group. Though we all hold professional degrees in various disciplines, our company believes in the importance of training and upgrading our knowledge. Being responsible for millions of dirhams in terms of company spend, it was critical that a proper and solid foundation had to be laid within the procurement department. We wanted to move from a department performing transactional and administrative functions to that of a strategic and dependable arm of the organization. With this quest in mind, three of my team members and I enrolled into CPP and CPPM courses with the Blue Ocean Academy. We had a very interesting instructor in Percy Engineer, who, due to his varied career portfolios, was able to add a lot of value and insight into the training program, let alone the fun we had. It was like going back to college again, so much so that when the classes finally came to an end, we started missing them during our weekends. The training venue was tastefully selected and easily accessible. Our training consultant, Jitendra Poli, was always on hand to greet us and look after our requirements. Never once did he miss sending us the weekly SMS reminders, and his friendly demeanor and easy to approach attitude is commendable. On the whole, our Blue Ocean Academy experience was wholesome and very gratifying. It was value for money, and the skill sets and knowledge gained has vastly improved the quality and value of Al Shirawi operations. Thank you, dear friends.
Ladies and gentlemen, Sharila, thank you very much indeed. And of course, we're inviting Mr. Mohammed Kamal from Landscape Construction to give his 2 minute feedback on the experience.
Good evening, everybody. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Let me introduce myself to you. I am Mohammed Kamal, working for Gulf Green Landscape as the project and procurement manager. Let me start with, first I want to thank Blue Ocean for giving us this opportunity to gather with this very professional crowd. And it's fair to say that I had a wonderful experience with Blue Ocean. Started with taking up a course for CPP, but now I have completed all the courses for for procurement and supply chain management, and recently I have obtained the certification for black belt for Six Sigma, and I'm still planning for more. Actually, another point I need to mention is that one of the most key concepts in procurement and supply chain management, it's always to seek the best value for money. And I think Blue Ocean, that's exactly what's providing its students. Once again, I thank Blue Ocean for the improvement of my career. And I thank all of you for hearing me. It was really my honor to talk to you tonight. Thank you.
So I'd like to invite onto the stage, first of all, Abdul Aziz from Blue Ocean Academy.
Thank you.
I'm now joined by Ahmed Hamdi, who's going to give his two-minute brief summary on his experience.
Hello, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Ahmed Hamdi. I'm working in GE Power as a sourcing and supplier quality management. I've been in contact with Blue Ocean for almost 1 year now. We completed our Green Belt certificates and certification and Black Belt as well. We benefited a lot. One of our cultures in GE is to stay leaner, to go faster, and to optimize our performances in order to go faster in this competitive world. So in order to get leaner and to optimize our processes, Six Sigma is very important in our career and in our market. And we achieved the Six Sigma really from a very credible training provider, very accredited, and have the knowledge. It's very important to seek a training provider who really has the knowledge that comes to you and to be dissolved to the students and to really benefit from in the professional life. I really want to thank the coordinators, Mr. Chris, the instructors, Dr. Shalapathy, and all the students. And we had this with a success rate of 100%. Our group had this Six Sigma black belt with a 100% success rate. Thank you very much, and we thank you.
And inviting onto the stage for her opinion is going to be Maria Cinderella.
I am Cindy, and interestingly, I come from an education industry. So what I would like to share is my experience with Blue Ocean Academy, which I have recently completed my Six Sigma Green Belt, and I have decided to take on my learning further by taking the Six Sigma Black Belt. Well, overall, I find Blue Ocean Academy, that they were able to provide trainees with international certificates or accredited certifications, excellent facilities. They have this excellent trainers, experienced and worldwide known. They have a high passing rate with certifications, and they got great, cheerful staffs. So, highly recommendable training consultancy for professionals who would like to take their career to the next level. And kudos to the organizing team and sponsors for this successful event. Thank you.
So, can I please invite to the stage Chris, who's going to be doing the reading of the certificates. And to award these certificates, it's Abdullah Hussein Al-Anazi from Amiantit. Great to have you back with us and into the center. Ladies and gentlemen, this sector is the Six Sigma Green Belt and Black Belt. Manish Kaushik, who is from Al Wasl Group, to give his two-minute summary.
I really sincerely thanks and joy also I can say about that I'm getting this certificate. We had a very good experience of 6 weeks with Blue Ocean Academy, and I not only learned the intricacies of international contract management, but really share the very good instructors. Mr. Rajesh was there. He was just a panelist before I saw him. I haven't met him, in fact. And I got a good, very good company of friends whom I have a very good interactions, and I really sincere thanks for them too. And I'm really, I shared a truly amazing experience with Blue Ocean Academy, and I sincerely thanks Blue Ocean Academy, and I'll really remember this remarkable course in my career. Thank you very much again.
So I'm going to hand over now to our reader, Abra, and it's Shailene Shukla, who is going to be giving the awards from Jumbo Logistics. Let's welcome them to the stage. This concludes yet another conference. May I please thank you for remaining behind. Thank you, photographers, for creating those bigger numbers. Thank you to Blue Ocean Academy, Atlantis Hotel, all of the support staff, the behind-the-scenes staff. Congratulations to everybody with a certificate. And ladies and gentlemen, a very safe onward journey home. Thank you and good night.
Despite not being from the procurement background, I think I pretty much got a really wide perspective of what it entails. I'm from the HR background, but attending these conferences definitely makes me know my candidates better while interviewing them now. Now I know what questions to ask and what to expect as an answer.
Yeah, thank you very much for that, arranging such a beautiful program. It was informative. But a few things were lacking. We have written down in the form that some visual and presentation should be more better if you include visual effects in this program. Otherwise, overall the program was very good and we appreciate that. And it should be continue every year, so more beneficial for the professionals. Thank you very much for that arranging this program. Thank you.
First of all, thank you very much for arranging such informative conference. We have learned about too many informations that is too useful for our in routine business dealing. And we have suggested some more informations and options that will be also, we hope that will be included in next conference and it will be more better. Thank you very much.
It was a great experience to join the Blue Ocean Institute, and we gained a knowledge from them and experience. And today I would like to thank them about that. Thank you very much.
All I can say is that it was fun and really exciting to be part of Blue Ocean Academy that can help not only on my personal but also with my professional career.
It was very nice, and I wish to attend it next year, inshallah.
good luck.
This conference give us more knowledge for the new innovation, especially when it comes to procurement and supply chain. So it will help us a lot to do our job. Thank you.
This is my second time to attend this conference. It was very excellent. As a businessman, I will say we have lot of things to learn from this. For myself, I feel we can learn many things as a businessman. We can have lot of idea, lot of experience from lot of people are coming here who has very big company, who managing big lot of companies, who are very success in life. We can learn lot of things from them. So I'm very happy to attend, and I wish I will attend again next year.
Yeah, it was good experience.
It was very good experience for us. Like, we got many experienced people over here. From there, we can start our new visions for the business, you know. For youngsters, it was too good.
In fact, this conference was not good. It was very good. And the knowledge which we gained from this, I think we cannot get anywhere outside. And I'm very thankful to Blue Ocean for giving me this opportunity. Thank you.
I'm very, very happy that I attended this conference. It was very insightful, and the comments and the suggestions given by the panel was very interesting, as well as it is going to be very, very useful for our future operations. It will be a great value addition, and I and the whole Al Sharawi team represented here are very happy and very proud to be part of this wonderful conference. Thank you.
It was a great course, and we enjoyed it every bit of it. And our trainer, Mr. Percy, was also great. So overall, thank you.
I really enjoyed this conference. Very informative. We gained lots of knowledge today, and really had fun, and had a good experience in this conference. Thank you very much.
I was so happy to attend the supply chain and procurement conference organized by Blue Ocean. Actually, I wasn't expecting that much people coming, but a lot of people came, and a very good speakers presented in this one. And I would like to thank Blue Ocean for inviting me this, and please do it again soon.
Hi, my name is Gaurav Paul. I was invited by Dr. Menon. I enjoyed attending the conference. There were some very nice presentations that I got to hear, some new knowledge that I'm taking with me. Thank you.
First of all, I would like to thank our president, founder president, Mr. Tumbe Mohiuddin, founder president of Tumbe Group. We'd like to thank him and for all his guidance and support he's been rendering us. And Blue Ocean, we would like to thank them for this prestigious award for Tumbe Group. And on behalf of Tumbe Group, we thank Blue Ocean and continue their best work possible. And it was a fantastic evening where we all thoroughly enjoyed. All professionals came together, supply chain, human resource, everybody came together. I think it was a fantastic event. Kudos to the entire Blue Ocean team, and thank you so much.
We would like to thank on behalf of Tumbe Group, the Blue Ocean team, for giving us the award. This award, really enjoyed the evening. And we would like to thank our founder person, Mr. Tumbe Mohiuddin, for his continuous support and encouragement. Without his support, we will not reach, the purchase team will not reach to this level. Thanks to our founder president. Thanks a lot. Thanks to the Blue Ocean team. Thank you.
This is quite informative and quite experience to heard a higher hierarchy professional about the subject.
I'm mostly from an HR background, but it's all even nice to know about procurement and supply chain. Thank you very much.
I would like to thank that I have attended a tremendous conference over here. This was a fantastic, and I enjoyed a lot with my team. And I wish a best of luck for my career, that I will be applying all this thing which I have learned today itself.
This is my first time for this international procurement and supply chain conference, with wherein Blue Ocean has given me this platform. And I feel it's been very productive for me as and my company. We've actually had a lot of good contacts, a good platform to introduce my company into this large business, for a large business opportunity here in Dubai. And I believe this is a great platform for
for any supply chain and logistics individual to actually come in and represent their company and to learn individually as well for them. And for me, it's been a positive day throughout the entire day, and I look forward to this in the future as well.
My name is Muhammad Farooq. I represent Wincraft Furniture LLC, Dubai. I attended this international procurement conference. It was a good experience, and we met a lot of people who are doing the best practice in procurement and logistics supplies. We learned a lot, and it was really a good session. Thank you very much.
Yeah, the conference was very good and very informative in terms of the new trends and what's happening with supply chain and procurement industry.
Hi, my name is Sunil. I'm purchase manager for Boutique 7 Hotel and Suites in Chikom area. I just want to thank Blue Ocean Academy regarding my career. Now I am 10 years in Dubai in the hotel industry. And actually it's CPPM and CISM. I already passed with the Blue Ocean Academy. I just want to thank Mr. Jitu, who's connecting with me always. And it's a really good opportunity for us to improve our knowledge in the procurement industry. And so Blue Ocean Academy always, I can say it's good place to improve our knowledge in the procurement industry, especially in the hotel industry. So I have been past this CPP and CPPM, I think during 2013. So still I am connecting with Blue Ocean Academy. So I would like to thank all the management of the Blue Ocean Academy and the American Purchasing Society. So we give a good opportunity to learn more, and even this this procurement managers this summit today, so it is very helpful for us. So we learn a lot of things. So especially I thank all of the organizers of the Blue Ocean Academy, and Mr. Percy Engineer also, he was our lecturer before. So thank you very much.
This is my first year attending. It was a pleasure. Definitely worth the drive from Abu Dhabi. Some new insights into different industries that obviously I don't work in as to how procurement impacts them and some of the issues that's facing people within the region. Very insightful and very delightful, and definitely going to attend in the future.
Hi, myself Tejinder Somani. I'm a procurement manager for our export training group, and this is the platform. No, the Blue Ocean is giving the having the introduction with all the procurement managers and director level officer, high top management, and all the top level management, their strategy, and all the companies. They are sharing the facts about this their own group. So it's a very good platform. It's a pleasure, and thanks Blue Ocean. Thank you. See you next year, 4th. International procurement and supply chain. Thank you.
What do you expect out of a conference is two things. One is learning, and the second one is opportunity. I think in this case the conference served both. It was a great learning experience, and the opportunities that came out of it were abundant as well. So I look forward to the next year. Thank you so much.
I think today's conference was a great event for us, especially people from supply management to attend. We had great speakers. People have shared a lot of their current challenges as well as the future planning. So I'm sure beside me, everyone whoever has participated in this conference will be a great help to them. Thank you.
No, it was excellent. Especially, regard to Ramesh, which was from the Dubai Free Zone, where he highlighted the future. So that is very excellent to know. And as a supply chain, so we can plan according to the population and everything. That's all.
Hi, good evening. I'm from Global Food Industry Sharjah. I'm participating for the supply chain conference in Palm Beach. Today is a very good conference about this very knowledgeable and a very intelligent conference. Thank you very much.